from all over Ireland and from further afield head for Croke Park.
Donegal are champions, and very, very worthy champions.
Sam is here.
Liam lives here.
And that McCarthy Cup going back down to Kilkenny.
Liam's lived here many times.
Champions!
Sam's lived here the most.
With a name like McCarthy, Liam should live here.
Heffo brought Sam here.
It's been a while now since Liam lived here.
From the mountains of Mourne
to the kingdom,
to the sunny southeast,
from the hills of Donegal
to the home of hurling,
from the Royal County,
the summer starts here.
It's inherently about what we are. Truly Irish, an indigenous sport with a global appeal.
There'll be pride and passion,
power and strength,
drama,
joy and pain.
We'll wear our colours,
fly our flag,
for young and old.
It's history. It's about legends.
It's family.
It's ballet.
It's the hill.
It's who we are.
Liam lives here.
Sam lives here.
Liam lives here.
Sam lives here.
Liam lives here.
Sam lives here.
Liam lives here.
Liam lives here.
Sam lives here.
Hello and welcome to the Sunday Sports Show on a special Bank Holiday Monday edition. Once again, joined by Down's PRO Paul Rooney and special guest Ross Kiar. Ross, you're very welcome.
Thanks very much, Damien.
Come in and talk a bit of rubbish or GAA with the two boys. You might get a word in with Paul, but we're delighted to have you in anyway. And we're going to run through maybe yesterday's scores in the Championship. Sean, stick them up on your screen there, and then we'll run through each match and we'll maybe preview the Down and Derry match next Sunday. So results from yesterday, from Saturday and Sunday: Donegal 210, Tyrone 10 points, Wicklow 115, Longford 16 points, Laois 16, Louth 116, London 112, Sligo 14 points, Kerry 218, Tipperary 8 points, and on Saturday evening Limerick 8 points, Cork 317. So first of all, we'll talk about Donegal and Tyrone, and a comfortable win, Ross, for Donegal yesterday.
It panned out that way, Damien. Yeah, it was, I suppose, going into it, I didn't think that they would win that convincingly, but I think at the end the scoreline flattered Tyrone a wee bit. Really enjoyed the first half. It was pretty intense. I think maybe the weather spoiled it a wee bit, but they worked it. Jim McGuinness has done over the last couple of years has been nothing short of amazing. Yeah. To change a group of players who traditionally or historically had been maybe less than convincing when it came to the battle, and all of a sudden now you are steamrolling teams. Very, very impressive.
They really seem to all the lads have bought into Jim McGuinness's thinking, and is maybe it's supposed to be the hardest training maybe anybody's ever done, and all the lads is knuckling down. And as you say, maybe some of them was hard to manage over the years, you know, doing their own things and not training and social lives or whatever. But they really put their shoulder to the wheel this last 3 years, and they're getting their awards.
Absolutely. And I suppose the one thing that he can work with is that not only has he got ability, but he's got physical size and presence as well. And when you combine the two, it's a pretty potent mixture. I've been overwhelmed by the performances and even his trust in his own players. You know,
yeah.
Right from the word go this year, he said that the league, he wasn't interested in the league, and to be as dismissive of the league as early as February, and even the day that they were relegated, he kept preaching that the, it was the 25th of May against Tyrone was the only one that he was con-, and that had the all the potential to be a banana skin for him, because had they not have won that yesterday, but he has them, as you said, he has them eaten out of the palm of his hand.
And another thing, Ross, you mentioned that he had to start with two of his main players on the bench, Lacey and Young McHugh. And like things like that unsettled things, but didn't unsettle Donegal in any shape, form at all.
No, you're 100% right, Paul. Like the I think the impressive thing for anybody watching it is that there is no individual, and there is a system that is played, and no matter who fills the position, they play the system.
Yeah.
And I suppose it's, I'm not saying it's easy to do, but when you're successful, you can get people to buy into it.
Yeah,
you
know.
But he has taken, like, not that long ago, we played Donegal in a McKenna Cup game in Newry, if you can remember, a few years ago, and they were beaten by about 20 points or something. They scored 5 goals that night.
John McGreevy scored 3-7 or 3-8 or something.
That's right. Big Jaggy was playing. And there's about half a dozen or 8 of those fellas still playing.
Of all Ireland medals now.
And
of
all Ireland medals. And after yesterday, you wouldn't want to be betting against them having 2 All Ireland medals at the end of this year.
No, no.
You wouldn't. The full forward line is absolutely brilliant. Morphy. McFadden and
McBrady's
a standout player, 19 years of age. He's one of the best in Ireland doing the cross, isn't he?
Ah, he is. Yeah. But you probably can appreciate it because of where you played and the campaign you had in 2010 when we got to the All-Ireland Fine. Was you had a couple of phenomenal performances that year, but those three full forwards are all over 6 foot, maybe 6 foot 1, 6 foot 2. They all seem to be in round 13 and a half, 14 stone.
Yeah.
They're all quick.
Very mobile.
They all put their hands about. Like, how do you keep marking that? You can be having a great game and all of a sudden there's one slip. Like, apart from the two chances that they created yesterday, would they have created another goal scoring chance? But they took them.
They took them and they got them, and that makes the difference. Yeah. But, we're saying that Donegal, okay, it wasn't great to watch maybe sometimes, and people, a lot of club teams maybe trying to replicate it, but how do you counteract that system?
Yeah, well, the concern I had for Tyrone yesterday was that a lot was being made of the free-taker, Niall Morgan, the goalkeeper.
Yeah.
And to get to the league, and even when they were only beaten by a point, he has scored 20
points
in the National League. Now, if you went through, I would say there's quite a few inter-county forwards this year didn't score 20 points in the National League. Quite a number of them. So, Tyrone really depended on him to win games. And there's always that chance that if you're hitting frees from anywhere between 45 and 60 yards, you're going to have a bad day at the office, and as soon as you have a bad day, where do you replace those 4 or 5 points from?
Yeah, well, he had 20 in the league. Michael Murphy and Stephen O'Neill was only 2 players in the pitch yesterday. He had more than him. And he had 6 attempts, 4 wide, 1 short in the keeper's hands, and he scored 1 point.
Well, McGinnis deployed a bit of a tactic on him too, but you must remember he put the 3 tallest men on. They were breaking the rules too. They stood directly in front of the 3. Every time, and it narrowed the lane of sight, and it narrowed everything for Morgan, and it was pressure right away, and the referee didn't seem to move them back, and they moved forward and forward into him, and it upset him, and you could see it as the game went on, he was getting worse.
Yeah, he's only 22.
He's only 22.
And everybody knows that you can have a nice, good, comfortable league campaign, and if you miss a couple of frees in the league, it doesn't really matter. Unfortunately, if you miss them in the championship, and one of the things that he probably did show yesterday was a wee bit of naivety or immaturity. When after he scored the first one, he came down and he was acknowledging the crowd with a few gestures and that sort of thing. And he'll soon learn that you only do that if you've scored the last kick of the game to win, because there's always another time.
It backfired on him
big time. But it, you know. No one can fault what Mickey Hart has done in Tyrone. But yesterday he was found wanting.
Yeah.
You know, the refusal to change that free taker. Young Michaliski started off well.
Yeah, yeah.
I know he was booked.
Yeah.
But surely to God, if you trust somebody to be an inter-county footballer, you know, well, I'm booked and I'm not going to go into any more silly challenges.
Yeah, yeah.
Peter Hart was booked. He didn't take him off. Joe McMahon was booked. He didn't take him off, and he was ultimately... you know...
We would have it here before that, Ross, and we were saying about the thing of Joe McMahon and them, that he's a great footballer and all, but he's not an ideally suited type of player to be playing against your Donegals. He's not mobile. He's not going to really... You know, he's a great big strong fella and all, but to beat the Donegals in that, they need mobility, and that's the biggest factor that they need to be playing these teams. I also question the fact of Peter Hart, corner forward. Like he was deployed last year as a half back, and his best work was attacking from half back. He was lost yesterday in the corner forward. He didn't know what he was doing. He didn't really know his role, I don't think, in the game.
I think that's one of the standout, I suppose, moments of yesterday, or collective moments was yesterday, that Donegal got big performances out of their big men, and Tyrone didn't, apart from Conor Gormley, who I thought was immense.
That's very good, yeah.
But the two McMahons, Peter Hart, Stephen O'Neill, all got tough times. And when you're... Sean Kavanagh tried hard, but they were at him from day one, and whenever anybody got an opportunity to either put a hand in his face or to bump into him or to say something to him, they never missed. Like Donegal are every bit as ruthless as any team has ever been. They win. They go to win, and they set out their mark pretty early.
Well, Donegal more or less done the Tyrone what Tyrone do to everybody else.
You know, absolutely.
And they stood up to them. They're maybe playing their tactics to another extreme.
Well, they bullied them.
It's the first time I ever saw a Tyrone team bullied.
They did.
You know, the several instances yesterday where Donegal people just pushed Tyrone fellas out of the way, and it was nearly a case of a senior team against a minor team.
Yeah, yeah.
And yet, you know, Tyrone kicked maybe 10 or 11 wides, missed two really good goal-scoring opportunities. Now, the one early on that that chap took us, McDonnelly took his point for, you could see why he took his point. It was early on in the game, but McFadden took the goal. McBrady set up the goal. Peter Hart had an opportunity and didn't take his goal, or it was blocked. But those, if you think of the chances that Tyrone had, you know, teams will get chances against Donegal. Last year in the Ulster final, in the first 12 minutes, Down tore them apart and should have had maybe 6 or 7 points on the board. But once you don't do that, if you're chasing the game against Donegal, you're beaten. Like, the game was over at half time.
Yeah, well, the way we've been trying to work out how to play that system is that you need to get a good start, you need to get in front. And, you know, if Donegal or whoever that plays this system gets ahead of you, they close up shop nearly from after 15 minutes.
Yeah.
You know, it's hard to get back 2 or 3
and
points down.
Absolutely, and they don't care about then scoring.
Yeah, we've more than
Tyrone had numerous chances at 9 points, had numerous chances to go in front. And it's that level for maybe 15 minutes when neither team's scoring, and Tyrone couldn't get the point to take them in front. Which made it
score for almost 18 minutes.
That's right, the two teams sat scoreless for at 1-6 to 9 points. It must have been maybe 10 minutes. And in that 10 minutes, Tyrone had several opportunities of points to go that point ahead, but they couldn't do it. Donegal ultimately took them out and punished them for that inability to, you know, to register when they needed to register.
And I think that's when, I suppose, you go back to Armagh last week, and there was a lot of huffing, you know, and a lot of probably false hope going into the Armagh, the Ulster Championship camp from Armagh supporters, maybe. I think people have got to realise that Armagh supporters, Tyrone supporters, that they were incredibly lucky to be about when their respective teams had such fantastic players. Like Armagh in the last 10 years, well, say from 2000 to 2008 or 9, you had Marsden, McConville, Clark, McDonald, the twins.
McGinnies, here.
You know, a forward line with maybe five of the best forwards, not only in Ulster, maybe in the country. And Tyrone, similarly.
Yeah.
You know, Duher, O'Neill, Canavan, McGuigan, and Muggsy, and Stephen O'Neill. Incredible. Incredible footballers. And you're not going to replace that sort of talent.
Yeah, and supporters get, you know, when they get into this, sitting where Armagh maybe played in 8 or 10 Ulster finals in a row.
And just need to be thankful that they actually
got this witness.
Few bad calls yesterday too, Ross, and you mentioned it earlier. Young Migaleski thought it was a harsh call. He looked lively enough early on. And in the league final, he was probably their better player.
In their last match,
he was their best player in the field. I think Mickey, I don't know, he made a few rough decisions yesterday on the lane. Do you not think?
Well, isn't it? Doctors differ, patients day. You know, it's... I suppose when you're at that stage and you make a call and it works for you, you're a hero. And if it doesn't work for you, definitely looking at it, I thought it was a bit rash so early in the game. And I don't think, you know, I also think the sending off Joe McMahon was very harsh. I think Murphy really milked the whole occasion. And McQuillan maybe didn't make the decision, it was the umpires, but you could have seen it was an innocuous enough challenge.
Yeah.
And for some of the things that happened throughout the game, you picked up on it earlier, Paul, like the two or three Donegal boys standing in front of Morgan.
That was ridiculous.
That's not Donegal's fault. Like, McQuillan should have stamped
it
out.
If he'd done it in the first one,
He didn't stamp it out.
And there was one, early on, there was one instance where one of the Tyrone fellas actually stepped out the 10 yards.
Conor Gormley.
Yeah.
And McQuillan didn't do anything
ignored
about it.
Yeah.
He ignored it, and it worked in Donegal's favour. It's all tactical theory to win these matches. And McGinnis had it right, hadn't he? He got it spot on. And he's bound to be fairly sitting back, lapping it up after watching that.
The amount of question marks that were over this season, the last time that Donegal won the All-Ireland in 92, they celebrated it for... They were celebrating it for 20 years. The very fact...
You would have been Celtic delighted to get them in the first round the next thing year.
Distract them.
Would the Celtic thing distract them?
Didn't.
Would relegation or his subordinate apathy towards the National League, was that putting them off? He's got everything right. And if you think of two years ago, when Dublin beat them in the All-Ireland semi-final, people talked about that was, you know, they were only learning. They were a kick of a ball from being in an All-Ireland final. If Colin McFadden had scored the 1-1 with the keeper when they were a couple of points up, the game was over. And who's to say they wouldn't be going for three All-Irelands back to back? I tell you what, and I know Pete did an incredible job here. Mickey Hart has done an incredible job in Tyrone. Joe probably to a lesser extent in Armagh. Well, we don't know what's going to happen with Donegal.
Yeah.
But I would say McGinnis's performance so far has been close to perfect.
Yeah, but the first year, as you say, everybody hated the way he played the football, but he played to the boys' strengths. He knew they weren't that fit to do the breaking out. And the difference in the year two and year one is the condition of the players. Once they break the ball down, they all go, and they can't live with them as down. You know, when the Ulster final last year, they run through us second half. You know, it's just the physicality and the condition that them boys is in to play the system that he wants is unreal. He shows the big picture that he has.
I think you're right. It's not only the pace at which they run, but it's the size and the pace, because you can stop them once or twice, But if you have to keep trying to stop 6 footers
and
13 and 14 stone boys for 70 minutes, all you need to do is miss one.
Yeah, and that proves over the last, you know, in games they run over teams in the last 10 minutes because you can only stick.
Yeah,
as we said earlier on, he hasn't changed the personnel that much, awful much. Like, it's not a new team we're seeing. It's not new players that have been unearthed from the Donegal wider elements. You know, these players have all been playing 5 or 6 years. It's just whatever McGuinness has done different.
Well, he's unearthed a few, and what he's done is
he's unearthed a couple.
He's changed, like, the whole mentality of playing for Donegal.
That seems to be
honest. The lads now, it's not. They were thinking it wasn't such a big deal. It was influencing their lives or travelling to Australia, whatever. And now, young lads, 15, 16, 17, just gear their whole lives to getting on the Donegal.
Yeah, I think squad, that you know? One of his the key decision for me was the way he just got rid of Cassidy.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, he thought, and I honestly believe that. Could be far out with this, but I think he knew he had to get rid of Cassidy if he was going to take this to another level. And at the first opportunity,
he was waiting on his opportunity, I nearly think
he was waiting on, because in the bigger scheme of things, did Cassidy do anything awful wrong? I don't know. You know, if you betray the panel or what the team is all about, then could he have been given a warning? Maybe so. But as soon as now, could you imagine anybody else doing that? With the fella who was close to player of the year, got an all-star, kicked the winning point in an All-Ireland quarter-final the year before, out in his ear.
Yeah.
And I think it also, what it did, it set the tone for everybody else that
that's just exactly what he used it for. And
if you step out of line, you're no good to me.
Well, with gentleman coming in next week, he might be able to let us in on a few seekers on that behalf. Declan Bogue's coming in to do a bit of a chat.
Oh, is he?
He would know about inside running and that whole thing. Don't know why he'd want to talk about it, but we're making something out of him, Ross.
He'll like you talking to Jimmy McGuinness. Anyway. That's a press conference.
No, he'll like you talking to Jimmy. But we'd allow him in to talk to us, Damien.
Yeah. But leaving maybe the Donegal thing, looking forward to down in Derry next Sunday. Involved, you were in probably the class that is the best match ever in GAA circles. Yeah, do you remember much about it? Or?
I do. The greatest contribution I made to that was being substituted for Kieran McCabe, and Kieran McCabe came on and scored the winning goal. So that was a massive throat by Pete.
Big plan. Get Carr off.
Yeah, get Carr off. He's useless. Get McCabe on, he'll score the goal.
Well,
I don't really remember an awful lot about it. I remember not playing well. I remember being marked by Fergal McCusker at wing back, and he scored a goal. So from a forwards point of view, it was the proverbial nightmare, but it was an incredible, probably a wee bit like yesterday, you know, both teams going into it knowing that if we win this, we're going to win the Ulster title and possibly the All-Ireland.
That was the first round of Ulster '94.
Yeah.
And Derry were Ulster and All Ireland champions going in.
We knew we didn't do ourselves justice the previous 12 months in '93. Going to Derry up in Celtic Park, we had a couple of incredible performances from key individuals. The boys were very solid in defence. Midfield was Connor and Gregory were competitive, but when you have three forwards all being top of their game, and Greg and Mickey and James that day were outstanding. Now they were, I'm not going to say they were perfect, but when you get three quality forwards all playing well just on the one day, then they're going to be hard to stop.
Mark Sidebottom yesterday, he made a big statement about one time Colin McFadden got the ball and he done a 180 turn and stuck her over the bar. Fine score. But Mickey Linton done the exact same thing in Celtic Park in '94. He got the ball and he counteracted a few men and he just done a circle like that, put it over his left foot. Reminiscent of McFadden, do you remember that one?
I do, yeah.
Super scored one.
James's point when he coming down the sideline and being tackled by Gary Coleman and Kieran McKeever. It was just incredible, you know, Blaney's pass to Linton, who then give it to McCabe for the goal. There's a whole lot, even there was one in particular, Neil Collins' save from Anthony Toholl.
Brilliant save, yeah.
In the first half when they were well on top.
Yeah, it finished us. Brilliant.
Connor Deegan went down on his on Toholl's boot. And then probably the changing of the game, Brawley had Joseph had a fantastic opening.
He had, he was fired, he was.
Maybe 15 minutes in which he scored
on John Kelly.
3 points.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, Mr. Kelly got the curly finger about an hour before me, or half an hour before me. And we put on the enforcer, Higgins. And that was the end of Mr. Brawley.
Yeah.
I think he's still watching behind him for us. Is he coming?
You wouldn't be speaking about Paul Higgins the way he is with some managers at the minute.
No, no, right. No, indeed.
He
so,
right.
But next week is a big game. Probably a big game for Down, more so than Derry.
Hmm.
Derry's season already is successful, having won the Division Two title. Huge game for us, and I think we were better in the league than people.
Yeah.
People have just glossed over. Oh, Down were relegated, they're poor. Down had some decent performances in the league. Possibly 10 seconds of madness did cost us First Division survival. And even the weekend down in Kerry, the St Patrick's weekend where they played Kerry and Tralee, there was enough chances in that game to get something out of it.
And the first game against our own too.
Oh, without a doubt.
Very much, yeah, so.
Without a doubt. Down could have ended up finishing the league with about eight or nine points.
The boys had played some of the best football we've seen in a number of years and just didn't get the rewards.
Didn't get the rub of the green.
You know, yeah, the wee bit of luck that
you need. You can hack it if you're beaten by a better team. And
what about the starting lineup? Have any idea where we're... What about Aidan? Is he...
Well, he played a wee bit in on Saturday in training, but I don't know how close he is to fitness. The concern I would have is the fellas that are coming back haven't played a big lot of football, but that's been blown out of the world yesterday with all the Donegal boys.
they'll hardly start, the fellas coming back, I wouldn't think, but Donoghue's a bit of time under his belt. Ambrose is a bit of game time under Spalton.
Yeah, but as you
I don't know, it'd be a big call to start them.
I don't think they'll start, but coming back and playing a few, 20 minutes for your club and then get in and play in the county championship is a big ask. You know, okay, Danny has the experience and Ambrose as well, but the injuries that they've had,
Well, it's going to be very important to the Down team, I think, and it's going to hinge on probably free taking ability if Donal O'Hare. It'll be a big pointer in the. In the direction of where this game could end up.
Yeah, I would agree with you. The only concern I would have about Ambrose and Danny is their game is based on pace and athleticism, and they can't have done the miles. So I don't think they're ready. Aidan certainly hasn't done the miles, so I don't know how they're going to be, especially as a defender. And as a forward, you can run once and take a breath and run once and take a breath. As a defender, you're chasing all the time.
And you've got relish in that centre-half back role too.
He played well, we know him, and he would
say to me, there's a lot of work involved in, but he seemed to settle in well at Ross. Who forgot to slot in there in his absence if he doesn't make it?
I don't know. I think Garvey's a huge loss.
He's a huge loss.
I think Garvey would get on any team in Ireland. I think he's as big a loss as anybody for them. I don't know what the story is with Declan Rooney. If he's...
You think Declan might slot in there then?
Well, Benny I think in Mayo, when we played Mayo in the last game, or we played Kildare in the last game there, when he got 20 minutes or 20 minutes or half an hour, he looked good.
Yeah.
And you got to see what we were missing. That's the unfortunate thing. Like, James is...
You've Ryan
he's spinning plates at the minute.
You have Ryan Mullen sort of floating about for that area too. And Boyle didn't show bad in the league.
No, he had a very good league campaign. Probably was close to Down's best.
Yeah.
best consistent great campaign and then
over the whole league.
Well, the middle of the field then, who with Kevin and Callum?
Don't think he can change it.
Can't really.
In fairness to Kevin, I thought Kevin's last two or three games, he like against Cork, Kildare, Mayo, he was phenomenal. He was very, very good from the middle of the field. And you're going to need that type of player coming through to get on to the end of things.
Yeah. Which Callum doesn't do for you.
No, Callum's not going to do for you, but he's going to be a big player on Sunday because they're physical around the middle of the field, Derry, and we'll need somebody that size.
Yeah, yeah.
The only the one of the things, Talley and McCabe aren't going to come up with anything new that James doesn't know about. And the other thing that I don't think you can underestimate too much is that we've already seen with the National League that playing in Division 2 is nowhere near the level of Division 1.
Mm-hmm.
And Armagh and Galway both bit the dust. And I know you could say Cavan were only in Division 3, but it just showed you the level that Armagh and Galway were at, and Galway beat Derry and Armagh drew with Derry.
Yeah, yeah.
So I think that Down won't be that far away.
No, I'm sort of from an inside and in the fall of a Down, but I have a funny notion Derry's sort of overlooking us a wee bit and are looking ahead of this game maybe and to some certain extent, Ross. Do you get that feeling? No.
Well, it certainly wouldn't surprise me. That'd be the nature of the beast in Derry. they're not any chance of sunshine. They're not too short of confidence, and there is possibly that chance. I think if Down set up defensively as they have done in the league as well as they've done, I think Derry'll find it hard to break them down.
Yeah, yeah.
The only thing is that Derry have shown that there's three or four fellas can kick points from 40 yards.
Yeah.
Mark Lynch is playing centre back, and I think that's weak link.
Strong. Yeah, yeah.
You know, I know he's big and strong,
but he doesn't have the defensive thinking.
I think it would be great if they left him on Poland, but I doubt it.
No. Well, Talley and McGave, as you said, nobody knows why he's any better than them two lads, and a wee bit of motivation, maybe the feeling they should have been maybe still there.
Yeah.
Do you know, they use all these things like McGave. He knows every footballer in Ireland inside out, especially the Down players. But we're going to have a couple of minutes just to the 94.
If you skip between the 10th and 15th minute of the second half.
Well, we're going to. Well,
this
I
is
think
one
you
could
call
it. You remember this? It's only a wee bit of a clip of it, but it'll bring back good memories to the folks out there that we're all capable of dealing with these Derry sides, and we've dealt with them before. So bring it on Sunday, ha.
And it'd be no surprise to notice that Tommy Sugru is one of the fittest referees in the country, and he'll be certainly up to the play. The game is on then. This long-anticipated game between two of the major counties in Ulster over the past 3 years. The All-Ireland champions of 1991 are taking on Derry, who lay on their line today their titles of Ulster and All-Ireland champions. Carl Diamond, the man who came in then for Johnny McGurk, is the first one to take this free kick. Ross Carr is pulled in the back, and the huge open spaces of Celtic Park certainly invite open play, certainly invite the ball in front, as that one to Aidan Farrell shows, and Down are going to be first to attack here through Conor Deegan. Conor Deegan finds Linden. Linden sells a dummy, fists it to the right and wide. And the crowd do an ah, but it's lucky for Down that that ball didn't go into the net, as a fisted goal doesn't count anymore, Peter.
Yes, but that was a move that Down would hope to repeat. Aidan Farrell coming out, space in behind, and the ball thrown into the flyer, Linden inside.
And the Gormley, noticeable this year, as the Linda is not wearing his customary knee bandage. He's been operated on over the winter, and he was telling me before the game that he's never felt better. The first kick from Derry then goes to Brian McCormick. For a break, McCartan's got the break, the shot and the block. That's good forward play and excellent defensive work. The switch, the left-footed kick, the Derry number 8, Gregory McCartan then gets his side, second point. Colleague Eamon Burns. Derry switching the play a lot. Toll on the rampage.
Here comes Stoffel. Oh, what a brilliant shot. And an equally magnificent save by Nate Collins. That had goal written all over it, but with an injury to a down defender.
The power and the strength of Anthony Toole shown there brilliantly. But what a miraculous save by Neil Collins. Coming in, shrugging off the challenge. Collins never took his eye off it.
Eamon Coleman shouting at him to change it to the short free. Joe Brolly now, faced by John Kelly. Joe throws it, fires it over the left, and if that goes over the crowd, will erupt. It goes over. Brolly remains aloof, but the Derry flags wave. A brilliant individual score by that man, Brolly. Now it's Tuttle. Down that avenue again he goes. No one there. Trying to square it in. Off the post it came. Still Tuttle. Such the strength of Tuttle. Even on the ground, still the player behind. They got a clash in the head. They give it to Brolly. And Brolly puts it brilliantly over the bar. Joe Brolly. He did it in Chasement Park. And now he's doing it in Celtic Park. Into the middle it goes.
There's all breaking ball in the middle of the field. Even the big men are getting them, and that's where this game is going to hinge.
Four down jerseys got between Brian McGilligan and trying to get that ball away. The broken ball in. Aidan Farrell. The left and a strike by Farrell. And over the bar it goes. And now it's Barry Breen. Up it goes well. Broken down by James McCartan. Now it's Aidan Farrell. Shrugged off Anthony Toole, and there's very few can claim to have done that. Lyndon turns with the right foot and kicks it over the bar. That's a great score for Down, and a brilliant effort by Mickey Lyndon. Greg Blaney, quick transfer to McCartan. McCartan finds Lyndon, not for the first time. Lyndon on the left foot. Lyndon with the point. Brilliant score by Down, and another brilliant one from Mickey Lyndon. Now who's first to react? Tony Scullion was straight off the ground. And this is a sign of the Down play, that they want to take these frees very quick. Tommy Sugar recognised that fact. The ball has moved up. Who's the target man? Lyndon again. Lyndon puts Down in the lead with his fourth point. In the... McCusker. Now it's Derry's turn to throw on the high ball. Brian McCormick's the target. McCormick's got it. Evaded that tackle from Higgins. And now it's Joe Brolly. Lyndon in one team, Brolly in the other. But here's the other part of the puzzle. Enda Gormley. Dermot McNichol thrown out to him. Forced across field. That's great work yet again by this Down defence. Standing up to the man and eventually blocking him. And what a forward can do. Soaked in the defender. McNichol got away with it. Dermot Heaney. Still Dermot Heaney. Toole. Trying to force his way through. Swings. Acrobatically. Flicks it off the top of the right foot. Sustained pressure by Derry. Rewarded and a point by Anthony Toole. Greg Glaney. McNichol did well. And Fergal McCusker adopted a sensible approach. Tried to find Gormley. Micheál McGill's there. And now it's Ross Carr. A lot of space. Oh, there's a mistake by Carl Diamond. Looking for him. McCusker's there. Dermot McCusker finds his brother Fergal. There goes the target man. Down need to catch that ball. Gormley got it. And Avila Micheál McGill, a man's in the overlap. That's Eamon Burns, and he sees him. There's Eamon Burns. There's the opportunity. Switches to left. Kicks it over. And Eamon Burns from Bandit Screen brings them level after 6 minutes in the second half. And up go the Derry flags. Carl Diamond pursued by that man McCartan again. And fouled. James McCartan's stamina has certainly been put to the test, and he hasn't been found wanting to date. The breaking ball then, Heaney, off balance, but still manages to put it over the bar.
Mickey Lyndon benefiting from that free.
A lovely strike by Lyndon, and it just proves here the keeper marked him brilliantly for 13 minutes. He let him go for 5 seconds, and Lyndon put it over the bar. Gregory McCartan, the Ballymartin club, the same club as Paul Higgins. He's 44 metres out. A lovely relaxed style, a high dropping ball. Amazingly the umpire signals a point. That's Chastity, the first man to react. Chastity first into the game.
If you don't get a clean pass in, you certainly don't get a second opportunity. Eamon Burns, a nice easy ball, playing into the path of Brolly. On the overlap is the half-back. Fergal McCusker trying to get through. The left foot, it takes in the net. It's in the net by McCusker. Fergal P. McCusker from Glen. He came up the, nobody picked him up. And he's rattled the net for the first time in this game. It all started here with Joe Brolly. Brolly fed it in. McCusker. There was the angle. There was no angle. The way was closed down. He still got away. In came Barry Breen. The block in the net. And away comes Damien Casty, the Ballaghy man. A fresh pair of heels here. Facing Barry Breen. Held up well by Breen. Looking for support. Forced to throw it outfield. And that's Joe Brolly, believe it or not. The right corner forward is in the left half forward position. Derry at the moment are playing possession. And Charles Diamond kicks it all away. It's at least 50-50. DJ Kane, he bends over it, bends down to pick it up, maintains possession, drives it downfield, a great ball from the down captain, Gregory McCartan. Left footed, gives it to James McCartan. James holding on to Charles Diamond, getting away from Charles Diamond, and now Kane, the keeper, takes over the tackling exploits. Still James McCartan, a perfect example of balance. If this ball goes over the bar, Celtic Park will erupt. It does. A magnificent individual score of persistence by James McCartan. That score had everything. So here it is again. This man McCartan, the thing that's been said about him is the fact that he's got such a low centre of gravity, but as well as that there is the way he protects the ball. Here he shields it from Kieran McKeever, gets the kick in. That's a poor kick out. Greg Laney gets it. Pounded by Diamond. That's a good ball. Linden, the target man. The chance, the shot. It's in the net. It's brilliantly finished by Aidan Farrell. The substitute it is. Peter Whitfield is it.
Kieran McCabe, the man. Brilliantly flicked into him by Whitfield. And what a finish from close range just underneath the crossbar. No chance. But a brilliant transfer to the man at speed. Defenders had no chance.
Great strike by McCartan against the breeze. It's over! It's over! Derry's, Ulster and All-Ireland titles have gone. The Ulster hoodoo lives on. And Celtic Park is a happy hunting ground as far as the down fans are concerned.
So that's give you a wee bit of footage of the 94. And hopefully we'll have the same result maybe next Sunday, Ross.
I think we'd all drink to that. I think we'd even take the bank holiday, the Southern bank holiday, next Monday if that happens.
There'd be a few boys on the bank holiday, no doubt, if it wins. But a great footage there, Paul. Thanks for taking that in. And we're going to throw the full match maybe Tuesday or Wednesday night online if people want to see the full game. Get a bit of nostalgia before Sunday. Get your old Kirsten Unic jerseys out and get up to Derry next Sunday. We'll run through maybe the down division results from Friday night. Sean will put them up on your screen there. Division 1, Sean. Anraic 1-7, Clonduff 2-8, Ballyhoon 2-8, Warren Point 13, Brian for 12 points, Anaclone 3-11, Downpatrick 5 points, Castlewell 1-12, Kilcoo 1-10, Ostrava 1-7, Leitrim 10 points, Bourne 1-11, Longstone 3-11, Saville 2-13, and Weybridge 1-9, Loughnane 12 points. You were at the Bridge match, Paul, were you?
I was, it was. And I have to say it, I'm a Bridge man myself, but if Loughnane had brought the shooting boots with him, Damien, the Bridge would have been beat for 12 points.
Yeah.
They missed an awful amount of stuff. And the Bridge, they're late at the minute, they've no Banny, and they're missing Cahill. They're missing Ryan Brady and Declan or Brenton Rooney's not playing. And you know, you have no Ronan Saxon. And you have Keith Quinn's not playing. You have quite a lot of boys there, you know, missing from that game. And there are a few young fellas in, young Barry Cunningham and that, but even though it's Loch and Isle and it's Division 1 football, it's hard enough for these young fellas to cut their teeth to this level.
Yeah.
They were found wanting some of them, you know what I mean? And it's an experience for them, and they might come through it at some stage. But you'd think maybe if you're going to cut a fella into Division 1 football, good enough opportunity to throw him in against Laughlin Island. At home, you'd be expecting the Bridge to. But like, despite that goal, it was a good enough goal from Keegan Gallagher. Other than that, at one time, I suppose I did see Darren Fagan's playing in the middle of the field for him. He's big enough fella, a big lad, and if it was me, he'd be playing in around the full back position. But he got the ball one time. I was up taking photographs at the nets, and he caught a lovely ball over by his head, turned, and he was 1-1 with the keeper. And like as Ross said a while ago, McFadden stuck it in, Donnelly didn't, and I thought Darren should have had a go at it, and he passed it over to an Alman to take the pressure off him, and the Alman went for it and hit the crossbar. The move was over, and Blackenheim should have won it, Damien. That's my verdict on it.
Right. The Bridge struggling now. You see, the Bridge is a championship team, but...
Well, you'll struggle with it. Them players are talking. I forgot about Conor Garvey too. Like, throw them players into any team. Throw them players into the Mitchells there in Division 4, and they'll become a Division 1 team too.
Right.
You know, they're a brave lot of players to have missing. And the Bridge had them back, I think they may
Supporters of Mayo Bridge have got to understand, Paul, is that very much like Tyrone and Armagh, they were incredibly blessed for 10 years there with the players, a group of players that they had. Like they had a forward line, and I would say at one stage there must have been five county players on it. You had Ronan and Noel Sexton, you had Michael Walsh, you had Benny, and you had Mickey.
Yeah.
And the other forward was Robbie Coulter, who was the top scorer in Down for about 12 years.
Yeah.
That's 6 year forwards, and you put to the back of that Francie Pone, Big Woods in the middle of the field.
Yeah.
There were Jimmy Coulter,
Grant as well.
Brenton Grant. They were an incredible group of players to have at any one time, and they just don't have them.
I think we're coming to that realization.
They don't have that quality, you know.
That we were lucky to experience all that at the time. Now, granted, they went on yesterday and won the minor sevens, but I don't know, I can't see it.
But you're always comparing them lads to the championship.
It's unfair to compare them. And we're looking through the results there, and Castlewell, sure, he's playing this open ground of football, and he's cleaning up everybody in the state, isn't he?
Castlewell's sitting top on 11 points. I think they've only dropped one. You know, I've heard his training is just throw the ball up and play a bit of football, and he referees it and he blows it up and tells them what they're doing right or wrong. And
from your own point of view, Ross, Clonduff, the scrape to win there over Anrecht. Was Arthur and Darren? Arthur and Darren's gone.
Gone, yeah, and they're going to lose another couple next week. Henry Brown and Rory Lavely and Shane McGreevy.
But he's just coming, breaking onto the senior team.
But we're just, you know, Paul and Tony and Martin are over them, and they're doing as well as they can. Mm. And in fairness to them, they had a bit of a blip the first game against Warren Point, but they haven't dropped. Well, Kilcoo beat them, and there was only a couple of points in it at half time. Since that, Clonduff have won the games that they need to be winning. You know, they're not going to win the league.
Do you think maybe the two boys we talked about, Arthur and Darren, would they have had a shout for maybe a position in the down team of Sunday if they had been about?
Darren, possibly, because I think James likes him as a footballer. I'm not sure about Arthur. I thought maybe a couple of times during the league that he might have got a bit of game time and didn't seem to. So I'm not sure if he fitted into his setup. But Darren probably would have. But these fellas go away. You can't blame them for going away. It's unfortunate. That's just the way it is.
Yeah, and we've all done it. And
we
can't give up to the last now for taking a chance.
Who's back in winning ways? And
Bourne sitting up there again, they're second with 10 points. You know,
they haven't dropped any points at all, have they?
I don't think they've dropped any.
Ballyhoun
got off to, I think, not a couple of the first win, maybe their second.
Yeah, O'Rourke said it here last week, they'll be all right. Seem to be coming all right, don't they? Well,
they're struggling with injuries. You know, even Warren Point, they would have missed the two county lads on Friday night. That would make a big difference to them. Ballyhoun's struggling with injuries.
Suspension. That was a huge win for Anaclone.
Away to Bransford. Nobody would have backed that.
I was talking to a couple of Saville boys yesterday, and they should have beat Longstone up in the Stone. Stone got a goal at the last kick of the game. And
the two teams mentioned, Ross, that we mentioned it here before, they've sort of established themselves as Division 1 teams. They've been up and down a few years, but they seem to be staying up there now, you know what I mean?
Salvin and Ballyhoon.
Salvin, Ballyhoon both, and even you could bring down Pathic into that too. Mm. Like, no, they were bait the other day, but 3 years going up and down the scene of selling themselves.
I think at this stage it's, you know, there's maybe only one or two teams that are going to win the league or championship.
Yeah, yeah.
And the rest are capable of beating each other on any given day.
That's the way a Division 1 is. Division 2, Damien, maybe rattle them, will you?
Yeah, if John has the results up there. Shamrock's 5-8, Saul 1-8. Kilif 2-11, Bosco 3-18. Glen 2-12, Clanavanna 8. Glasdrummond 12, St John's 5. Dundrum 9, Darracross 14. Carried off 13, Ballymartin 6, and Ardicall 113, Drumgath 12 points.
Good performances from what Ardicall. The Bosco bounced back big
Bosco,
time.
Bosco sitting on top of the league, they lost.
Flying on top of the league. And
won the next five.
Shamrock's had a goal haul the other night against Saul. And five goals.
Yeah,
was Mickey playing?
I wonder was he playing because
Mickey Keane or
Mickey? I went to see him the week before.
He wouldn't be allowed on the pitch.
No.
They never even got a chance at a goal out in Drumgath, never mind five. And right, there you have it, Ali Cole. You mentioned him, Damien, on the show earlier on. They're not bad side.
No, they were going well. We
at played home, they're hard to beat. They're very hard to deal with.
Actually, the manager told me that they prefer playing away because they have a new big pitch and they have to train on the old wee tight pitch and it doesn't suit them when it comes to playing matches. The pitch is too big for them, but they're doing all right there against Drumgath.
That's a good win for them, man.
Kerry Duff going well. You know, Glenn again, we played Glenn ultra defensive. You had a man sent off in the first 5 minutes, didn't help, but they played the system very well.
Look at the two goals quick fired in on you, quick no, after one another, were they?
Right, well, it was the last 10 minutes, 10 minutes ago they got a goal, then the next one was kicked out the goal. So the game was over, but played the system very effective. It's frustrating, Ross, if you're, you know, trying against that.
Yeah, and it's very hard to coach, to go and try and coach fellas to play football when you're coming up against teams that go out not to lose rather than going out to win.
How did
young McParnon play? Was he playing?
He only came on 10 minutes, 15 minutes to go. Done all right, but I think it was talking to him, his groins, I think he had the operation and he came back from it and then he done his calf or something. So he's struggling with that. But
so had Liam Bagnall playing well, Bagnall
playing, he was playing corner forward, but before the ball was through in, he sent a half back as next to the defender. And then the old young lad, Shane McCartan, I think, was back.
Did he play?
He's playing 16, I think. Good, quick young fella. But they know the system and they're playing it. And they went 8 points up and pulled another 2 men back, which is, I couldn't believe it.
Yes, we're never going to get over
that. We're never going to get over that. Like, you know, so I'm trying to pick your brains to see how you beat that. But
yeah,
it wasn't working. Playing Mickey Linton, you're telling me.
Division 3. Callum Rook says the best way to beat that system is good players. That's the only answer to it.
No, but there's no transfer system. You're stuck with what you have in some
time. Division 3.
Division 3. Ross put a lot of work into the Mitchells years ago, so it's all burned.
That was Stevie Poocher.
It's Poocher, is it?
Yeah, it wasn't me. Stevie Poocher.
Mitchells 15, Taconic 1-5, Achaderg 2-12, Dromara 2-10, Atlas the Finn 2-6, Killalea 2-8, Brighton St Michael's and Drummond S and St Paul's, I think must be played Monday night, are Glass 4-6, Ballykindler 2-3. So Mitchells, I think, are sitting top
with
Division 3.
They beat the tabletop team again. Our co-worker, Aidan Spud Murphy, involved again in major controversies. But this time, not like the last time, and where was it the last time? It was down in Achaderg.
Achaderg, he caused the wreck.
He caused a bit of an uproar. But this time, rather than last time, he gave a decision for a point early on. I think it was maybe the first or second point. It panned out that the Connacht ones had big support with him and they surrounded him big time and they were going to do this and do that as they do. But this time it worked out after 5 minutes discussion and back and forward. The referee agreed with Spud this time and awarded the point. And so I think from that on then it was a fairly lively affair.
Has Spud been seen since? He wasn't Leinster or anything.
Well,
I was
speaking to him since. He's all right. Like, he's come through unscathed, but he's getting involved in these controversies every week now, so he is. You'll have to forward him, Damien.
I'll have to wait to calm him down.
You will,
We'll run through Division 3 fixtures for Friday night. There's no 1 or 2, Division 1 or 2, because of the Championship. So, Division 3, Dromara host Arklas to Finn, Ballykindler play Achaderg, Ard Glas host to Connacht, Killalea play Bright, St Michael's play Drumminace and St Paul's play Mitchells. So good luck to all them teams on Friday night. Championship draws were made during the week, Paul. You were present at them. You were in charge of the slide show, I think, were you?
I was in charge of the slide show and everything went all right on my behalf.
Did it? Well
done. So them out slide shows, they're dodgy enough, Damien, at times, you know. Especially when you're dealing with groups and bowls and different things, it was tight. But
and you didn't stream it this year in case you got the draw wrong and pulled the same team out twice or something?
That's right, we didn't boss team this year. But we done. We Twittered it this year with Fiona, give me a hold from Glenn. But the, what, the people the
senior
will be
championship,
the senior championship, the groups
Sean
are.
Sean will put it up there.
On, Group 1, Mayo Bridge, Saville, Restrever, and Cumann, Peller, and Aoife, that's Warren Point. You'd have to look at it from now, taking off the bridge losses that were used this last 10 years, tight enough to draw for the bridge there, let me tell you. Top 2 from each group going through to quarter finals, an open draw, Damien. Group 2 is a tight group as well. Bourne, Bransford, Ballyholen, Alan Raked. Nothing easy there for.
No, you're
but you'd be expecting Bourne, Bransford, yeah, loss, wouldn't you, to come through on that
do,
one?
Yeah.
Group 3, Clonduff, Castlewell, and Latham, and Clone. You'd be expecting Clonduff and Castlewell.
I think, I tell you, I just wouldn't be too sure. I think Castlewell will come out of it, but I wouldn't be surprised if Anaclone
would be.
Create a shock or two.
And in Group 4, you have Kilcoo, Longstone, Downpatrick and Loch and Island, open off Group 2, like, with Kilcoo and any one of three, Ross, going through.
Who are the other three? Longstone?
Downpatrick and Loch and Island.
You'd still be looking for, I would say Longstone would be very disappointed if they don't come out of that. But you'd be expecting Kilcoo and Longstone.
Kilcoo and Longstone, yeah, but it, like, the new system, Ross, what do you think of the new Champions League? You think they're basing it on the...
Yeah, well, I think it's, you know, every team's going to get three championship games. I thought they might have actually played it a home basis, you know, that if you were drawn out first, you got a home game.
Yeah, but they're all neutral venues.
But apparently they're all neutral venues.
They're all neutral, yeah.
Would have been good to see, you know, good championship games going to gates.
You could
have a few. That would be the only thing that I would be looking for.
You have a couple of dead rubber games at the end of it all, like, but with round robin, that tends to happen in any competition, that you play that format.
Yeah,
you know,
but
I mean,
on the other hand, you may have a couple that'll be skin and hair flying.
So are you going to give us a tip, Ross, to win the championship then?
I think it's Bourne's to lose, Damien. I don't think Kilcoo will reach the heights of last year. I think Bourne got a huge shock against Longstone last year. I thought Gregory had Longstone at A1. And they really played out of their skin, and probably, unfortunately for them, that was their final, because Mayo Bridge tore them apart then in the semi-final afterwards. Say Mayo Bridge were, you know, Mayo Bridge weren't that far away from winning the county title last year. I just don't think they're as strong this year. I don't think they'll be able to replace the likes of Owen Woods, Conor Garvey, the Saxons, Cahill McGee.
We're here on our inside information sources is 5 Kilcoo boys apparently going to leave now shortly as well. Senior footballers are heading away for work reasons, and that'll affect them too, Ross. They're small enough wee club, like. Five of their senior players.
Well, they should have great numbers, you know. After last year, there must have been 30 senior players or 35. Nice.
I remember taking photographs of the dugout, and you couldn't believe it. It was massive, the amount of players they brought to them.
Well, I spoke to Jerome Johnson maybe 18 months ago when I was still playing, and he said to me that at the training they had, look, 70 lads trying to play senior football. And McCurry was going, like, he had 2 full teams out and you had 30 or 40 lads standing up the line trying to get on. How do you manage it?
Yeah.
He had to end up saying, look, this is my 30. The rest is for seconds, the rest is for thirds.
But there's something
up and down.
Yeah, there's something wrong there too, Damien, because the coup played this year, and Dara O'Hanlon and Jerome Johnson played for the seconds.
Yeah.
And those two lads played Intercounty National League football this year.
Yeah.
You know, both of them played under 21 championship football.
That doesn't make sense.
All the behaviour like that does, it leaves boys training that's never going to get a game, Ross. It's not fair.
It's not right.
I agree with you there, and I think that should be, you know, stamped on that thing, because this lad's going to train every week. They're training maybe not as hard as Dara on young Jerome, but Dara and Jerome get plenty of football. That's all lads there needs a bit of football, you know what I mean?
But that's what you reserve your thirds is for.
And like, from a young point of view, Mayo Bridge with a full stand side, Ross, they could still give her a wee bit of a jag, you know what I mean? There could be a sting in them.
Don't think so, Paul. I don't see where they're going to... If it's true that Noel and Ronan aren't, you know, are not available this year, Connor's not available this year.
That could be sorted out in the meantime, I assume, you know.
Cahill McGee's not available this year. And Owen Woods is retired. Well, but they're not going to replace those five players. And Benny will, you know...
On that, what you mentioned, Owen Woods, I said it after the match that day, and Owen Woods...
I had started him in the championship last year, they would have won the championship.
I said it after the match that night. I said going out the gate, to, I think it was our Sean John that we were having it. I said, it's funny, I says Owen Woods on the sideline would be better than the two midfielders that was playing for the Bridge.
Well, I you know, that's maybe a wee bit unfair, but Owen Woods is... Owen Woods was probably as good a midfielder as there was in the club for the last 10 years, in the county for the last 10 years. Club midfielder. Mm. He was a fierce presence, and you don't replace boys like that overnight. And those lads that are playing, you've got to remember, while Owen was good, he was playing on an exceptional team as well. That, you know, and he had a boy beside him, Daggy Rooney, that was as good as
done his running for him.
Done his running.
So you reckon Bourne then, if they can avoid Longstone, and
I think Bourne will win it.
You mentioned Gregory there. We've seen him skipping about there on the after the match in Derry. He done the same skipping and Park Esther off the bit
now.
Born that night, so he did.
He's a wholehearted fella, yeah.
He wears it on his sleeve, doesn't
definitely.
He? It's out there, like, there's no messing with him.
No, he's a great bit of stuff.
We're pressed for time, so we'll run through the intermediate championship. Sean, stick it up there. Group 1, Kai Duff, Saul, Dara Cross, and St John's. Group 2, Clannabanna, Glasdrummond, Glen, and Breda. In Group 3 is the Shamrocks, Drumgyath, Ballymartin and Dundrum, and in Group 4, Caliph, Tullalish, Bosco, and Arrecall.
So round robin stuff again, Damien.
New format, so it gives everybody a chance.
It does, you'll be in there yourself. And what group did you end up in?
Glasdrummond, Glen, and Breda, but.
Tight enough one.
Tight enough, yeah. Glen's going to be hard to beat, you know, playing that defensive system. Bosco,
probably the toughest group there, is it, Damien, by the look of that?
Yeah, could we play Glasnum at the start, and they were struggling for numbers, but I think they've got some boys back that was walking away. And
they're brave, tough groups too when you look down it. There's nothing easy for anybody there, sure. There's not.
They say at the start of second division, like, they're all second division teams.
It'll be hard for
nobody starting out that's going to run away with the league, and it's proven that at the minute. So everybody thinks they have a chance of winning the intermediate championship, and which they all do.
It'll be hard fought, like.
Yeah. Junior championship, we'll run through it. Mitchell's big favourites maybe in this. Group 1 are Glass, Dromara, Achaderg and Ballykinler. Group 2, Drummond AS, Bright, St Michael's and St Paul's. And Group 3, Mitchell's, Taconic, Harkness, Finn and Killalea.
And the way that works, Damien, is that the three group winners go to a semi-final, and the best runner-up from the rest join them in the semi-final, and that.
That's the way it makes
the four semi-finalists in that group.
Well, that makes it more important to win your group then, doesn't it?
Well, it makes it important. It gives importance of the best runner-up, you know, for the semi-final position.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you have much more, Damien. We'll have to run through it, maybe.
I'll run through the Cairnbean League and the darts and the pool that people's maybe waiting on. Cairnbean League from Saturday, AOH Cup quarterfinals, Windmill 2, Creve 1, Millbourne 0, Ashgrove 4, Grasshoppers 0, Bestbrook United 5. In the Premier Division, a meaningless match because the leagues is over. Rockview United 3, Whitecross 6. And the 5 is Youth Leagues Under 13 Knockout Cup, Brookvale 0, Valley Rangers 3. The Mully United 7, Ballybot United 1, Midway United 1, Millmill Stars 4. And the Dart League, sponsored by Newry City Tires. There's some of the Dart teams that really hear this now. Premier Division, Shane O'Neill's 4, Nummies A 4, Charlie 7, First and Last 1. Seasiders INFA 4, McCoy's Boys 4, Boyd's B 3, Mayo Bridge Social Club 5, Nummies B 3, Bosco 5, Hibs A 4, and McCoy's A 4. Division 1, Quinn's Camlet 8, Seasiders INFB 0, Gap of the North A 1, Three Steps A 7, CWC C 2, Hockey Club B 6, McGee's A 8, Murphy's Mike 0, Drummond T GFC 5, Forkill GFC A 3, Ballyhoon INF 3, CWC A 5. Division 2, Windmill Bar A 5, McGee's B 3, CWC B 8, Gap of the North B 0, to Cullen Mullabon 2, Trainer 6, Welcome In 6, Anne's Army 2, Lumpers Bar B 7, Doyle's Bar 1, Killeavy GAC 2, Lumpers Bar A 6, and Division 3, McCoy's C 4, Crenshago A 4, means McCoy's are Division 3 League Champions. Three Steps B 3, John Moore's 5, Hockey Club D 6, Ballyhoon Harps 2, Throuch Tavern 2, Sleeve Gherkin 6, Crenshago C 8, O'Hanlon's White Cross 0, Pet Shop Boys 6, Cornermuckle House 2, Division 4, Forkhill GFC C 8, Veronica's Army 0, Indo 2, Charlie's Angels 6, Trainers Heroes 8, Seasiders ANFC 0, Cove Bar 0, Hibs B 8, Howes Bar Meath 3, Boyd C 5, Hockey Club C 4, Windmill Bar 4, and Armagh Down Ladies at a Bay. What do we see now? What's left? A few fixtures. Tommy Hockey sponsored Cup, sponsored by Mark Taylor Electrical Contract at Camla. The semi final results: McCoy's Boys 4, McCoy's 8, 5, and Charlie's 5, Nummies 8, 3. The final of the Tom Hockey Cup is McCoy's 8 versus Charlie's, and we'll play it on the finals night, the 5th of July, in Bellini's. And this is a repeat of last year's final, and McCoy's 8 won 5-4.
McCoy's here seem to dominate that pool, don't they?
We're doing McCoy's are somewhere.
Are you McCoy's boys?
No, we're not. But there is one of McCoy's boys plays for McCoy's, so so we have to keep them up to the fore. But we mentioned there, but the Christy Ring was on Saturday, and with Sean's rushing us on here, we'll do this quickly. Go, but yeah, the Christy Ring semi final, and it ends up we're in the same position we were in last year. After a drawn match at 70 minutes and 10 minutes extra time each way, last year in Newry we ended up level with London, and this year we ended up level with Meath. So we've it all due again next Saturday, and a few talking points from the game was the down man, from my point of view. Damien reckons I'm a hurling man now, but I'm not. But I followed the old hurling a bit nice in the PRO, but from my point of view, looking in on it, and I'm sure Jared Mullen would share the same belief, our boys inclined to, when maybe get the ball out in the scoring position, magic in them that seemed to take it in to try and get goals, you know what I mean, instead of bopping it over the bar. And Paul Branoffin, one occasion with a 30 metre free, we were 6 points up, 30 metres out, you bop it over the bar, you put 7 in it, you know what I mean. But Paul doesn't do that, he has to go for the goal, you know what I mean, and it infuriates me, you know, it infuriates me. Like, at full time we were 3 points up, 4 or 5 minutes to go, and we conceded to give away a soft freeze to let an expert free taker, and I'll mention the man's name because
you told me he was the best.
He's a joy to watch, and he would fit into Kilkenny, he would fit into Cork, he would fit into any of the greater teams that we talk about here. Stephen Clinch, he's just 100% accurate. He's so unbelievable to watch. That's the second time this year I had the joy of watching him. He scored 15 points against us, 14 from dead balls, from anywhere in the position of the field, he put them over. So that tells me, from if I'm Jared Moon, am I sitting looking on here, this man here, if I can get him out of the game, he's not going to score. He scored 25 points, he scored 15.
Legal means,
well,
I'm thinking,
you know, if I'm Jared Moon, he done it to us in the league, we beat them in the league, right? He stepped up at the last to take a 21 yard free, and we were a point up. What does Stephen do? After scoring 14 points, he buries it to the net and beats us. So it's not as if we didn't know that he was involved. We've seen him in the league, we played them, they beat us by a point. Stephen Clinch scoring 113 or something, and he done 15 points that day. And you can't blame the lad, he's a wee will of the wisp, he's not that big. He's small in stature, and he's not a brute of a man. But Meath did bring a brute of a man, a footballer. Now, this is one for you. We talk about amazing facts on the show. They recruited a footballer. Meath was away for the weekend in some training camp, but the scent for this boy in particular to be brought, number 28 he was, he wasn't even in the programme or nothing, but he was brought to the Meath selection, and they deployed him after 15 minutes to do what? To snub out the influence of Gareth Johnson in the game, and he done exactly what it said on the tin. I have a photograph of him at one time. He is Gareth by the helmet like that, and the helmet's half off him, And there's no word of hurling in this boy.
He didn't need a hurling, no.
He didn't even need a hurling. Like, he done what he was deployed
to do. It's just a red card offence.
It's a state red card offence. And I have a photograph of it there, and Sean maybe showed them there. But he was deployed to do that tactic, and it worked. And he put Magic out of the game, and Magic got 1 point in the last minute of extra time. And our old friend Clinch appeared again in injury time and extra time to nail one over the bar from an acute angle to really punish, you know what I mean, the inability of our boys to not give soft frees away. And that's, you know, I'm usually not hard on the hurlers, but I'm going to be hard on them today. And if they could take out of their game this soft free taking, given opportunities to a man like that, you beat them all day, Ross. They're not superb hurlers. They're not in any way, shape or form. We did score from all over the field. We had Kieran Coulter and we had Daniel Toner and we had Magic scored and Branham scored a few. And you know, scores. Connor Woods scored probably the best point of the day from our own 21-yard line. It was unbelievable to see a man capable of doing this. He put it straight over the bar, and we were under. We were 3 points down going into the second period of injury time, and that 1 point lifted them again. They went forward and got 4 points to go one in front. Mm-hmm. But again, the ultimate and the killer man, Stephen Clinch, appeared and whopped it over to draw it again.
Maybe they'll learn for this week.
Well, that's the second time now. That's the second time he's done it on us. And we're hearing through Twitter and on our outlets there, while we're sitting here during the show, we're seeing tweets coming through that the match could be in Ballycran. And
good pitch.
I don't know. Good pitch, maybe, but from my point of view and from a press point of view and a media point of view and stuff, it's not a great venue for. Like, it's an All-Ireland semi-final, Ross, no matter what way you look at it. You'd be wanting to play them games in your home ground, who the players have got used to this last season. They're in it now. They're in the season. And we're going to uproot.
But they're opening up a whole
different. We're going to uproot the Masatri, and I think the thinking behind it, because Meath brought them away to Trim. And like, and from my point of view, Trim's an excellent spot. A facility, 4 or 5 dressing room showers. There's a whole viewing area over the whole stand. It's a lovely pitch. There's a 3G.
In fairness, now Down are interested in winning.
Yeah, it's not
on the replay, and if that means taking me to the as far away as they're not going to be too worried about who covers it or how it's covered. They want to win.
Well, that's your say on it, and I have the final say on it. That if Meath come to Ards on Saturday and beat us, there'll be red faces all round, and the one face that won't be red will be mine, because if it was left to me, it'd be played in your eye. Simple as.
I videoed the match the other day, and from a
neutral point of view, it was a brilliant game of hurling, and just scores from everywhere. And like, from our point of view, we lost it twice. Do you mean simple? We lost it twice, and Sean's tapping.
Jared Mullen's watching. He could put you on. What do you call your man?
Well, Jared wouldn't. Jared knows I have good time for the hurlers, and he knows I've good time for the boys. And I can name you all the down hurlers now, without any ball, and that's good. You know what I mean?
Could send you out to take Clinch out of the game, you mean?
Well, you could send somebody out. Maybe we could take Ross or Mickey Lynn, but I don't know why to take him out of the game.
No, they don't want to take him out of the game.
It could be to stop giving away a soft freeze. Could be the answer, because if this man's kept out from the scoring, Meath don't win the match. It's simple. And that's how simple it is.
We'll have full coverage up on the site during the week, and we'll just finish off with your amazing fact.
Yeah, we were here last week, and McCullough was here, Ross. We've turned this into a bit of a cult thing, this here. McCullough was here last week, and my fans were disappointed. Everything I said, he seemed to know about it, you know what I mean? He knew it already, like, so. I got a special one for this week, and he's not here now.
Keep it for you to hear.
I may as well let it go. Get another special one, Damien, but this is a special one for this week. It was for McCullough, and he wouldn't be able to say he knew this one, but Barbados, once in soccer, they had to score a goal against themselves to win a soccer match. Now, I'll explain that now out to you. You know, it's a big statement, like, but this happened in the Caribbean Cup in 1994.
Caribbean Cup.
Sorry. They were playing Grenada. And to get through to the next stage, Barbados had to win 2-0. Now, there were hot favourites in the game, and they went into a 2-0 lead, and late in the game, Grenada scored a goal against all odds. So, Barbados had to score another goal for themselves, or, as the manager thought, they could force a replay or force extra time. Mm-hmm. And in extra time, a goal scored just two goals. So he thought if he could force it into extra time, that they would get the first goal and they had to win by two clear goals, so they were winning. So what happened was, he got word out onto the field, Granada caught wind of the whole exercise and started defending. The funny situation was, Barbados were trying to score into their own goal and Granada were defending the opponent's goal. But Barbados did get the goal. It was tucked into extra time. They got the golden goal. The golden goal. It counted for two and they went on in to win the competition. So that's why they had to score a goal against themselves.
That's a winning goal cost fact.
In order to get through the next round of a competition.
Do you know something? I'm thrilled I came along to hear that.
There you are now. You wouldn't knew it, would you, like?
If I knew that,
I thought the manager was very astute and aware to think the way he did.
He probably coached Jimmy McGuinness.
I think the way he did, he knew the only outlet for him, it was dead, it was the end of the match. The outlet for him, it was 2-1, he was out. If he could score a goal and bring it to 2-2, he would have the chance. And he did, and that's the way it panned out.
Well, very good.
I hope we have a better one next week when McCall is here.
That is a good one.
That'll finish us up because we all have to go to training, so I feel you have nothing else to do. Ah. But thanks to Ross for coming in. Ross,
thanks very much, Damien.
Who's going to win next Sunday?
Repeat of 94, down by 2 points.
Down by 2 points. So we'll be happy enough for that. So we'll tune in again next Sunday if we're back in one shape.
If we come out of Derry alive.
So thanks very much, and we'll see you all again next week.
There you are.